from a former editor of the Capital Gazette, and I'm quoting now, "The Capital, like all newspapers, angered people every day in its pursuit of the news. In my day, people protested by writing letters to the editor. Today, it's through the barrel of a gun," close quote. That quote came from Tom Marquardt, a friend and former colleague of the victims of the shooting. He's joining us now. Thanks so much, and our deepest condolences to you, Tom. I know you're the former editor and publisher of the Capital Gazette. What was your immediate reaction when you heard this awful, awful news?
It's hard to describe, Wolf. I mean, you know, it was a blow. It was a blow that was really difficult to describe. I mean, after all this time, I've had to really think about it. But, you know, first there is the deaths, several deaths of people who you were very close to, who you worked alongside of for, in some cases, decades, and people who you hired. And then on top of that comes the news that the shooter was somebody who you also knew, not by sight, not personally, but through the record. And so, you know, it was one whammy after another, quite frankly.
Yeah, and I want to get to that in a moment. The newspaper, to its enormous credit, they did put out an edition today. The front page has the pictures of the five who were killed. How important was it, do you believe, Tom, for the staffers there to put out a newspaper on this day?
Well, I think it's very important because it demonstrates that through thick or thin, no matter what happens, they don't lose sight of the mission. And, you know, I'm extremely proud of them. Most of those reporters I don't know because there was a turnover after I left. But, I mean, they speak for anybody who's in the business that the objective is to put out a newspaper and get the story right. And I'm sure they did. The paper that they put out today was nothing short of a miracle. Yeah. It was they suffered through their grief. They suffered through just trying to cope with the tragedy and still got a cogent newspaper out and fulfilled their mission.
You actually did cross paths with the suspect, not personally, but you were named in his defamation suit against the newspaper that was later thrown out by a judge. But he specifically threatened a lot of folks at the newspaper, including yourself, right?
That's correct.
Tell us about that.
After the lawsuit was filed, unlike most people, most plaintiffs, they don't speak to the press for fear of jeopardizing their case. But what made this case weird is that he continued to rant on social media about what he thought of us and how we affected his life and how dishonest we were. It wasn't just cogent comments, but it was rants. And to the extent that there were a lot of veiled threats, some of which were really difficult to say, he never said, "I will kill you." What he was saying is, "I wish you'd stop breathing," or "I wish you were dead," and then post a photo of my former boss who had just died. So, I mean, it didn't take much to read into it, that it was a threat. It was a threat against me. It's a threat against the reporter. It's a threat against the staff.
The suit that he filed was in response to an article in the paper about his being charged with criminal harassment. He was given probation. He pleaded guilty. The judge referred to him as bizarre and called the case extreme. Did you believe at the time, though, that he was a physical threat to you and others at the newspaper?
Well, when the story was written by the reporter, I mean, we had a very factual story about what he had done. And there's no question, if you read that story, that his motions were extreme. I mean, the woman who he was stalking felt personally threatened and feels she lost her job because of what he had done. So, I mean, just looking at that, I think anybody in their right mind would find evidence of somebody who really had some mental issues. And I think that all that came out pursuant to the case that he filed. I mean, we were seeing evidence of that in his postings.
And you did go to the police and discuss this with them, right?
That's correct. I mean, we were taking the posture that the less said, the better, because we felt that if we had made as much of an issue as we could about this, that we would actually inflame Mr. Ramos and that he would retaliate against us at the time. So our attorney was advising us to let the courts take this case on and let it run through the courts without us making any comment either in a newspaper or personally. So, you know, when it came to some of these threats, especially the last two that I had mentioned, I thought he had crossed the line. And, you know, being fearful of what he could do to us and my family and the newspaper, I thought the most prudent course was to contact the police. Our attorney got involved in it. There was a conference call. The police had gone out to talk to Mr. Ramos, but came back and didn't think that the evidence merited any kind of a charge. Was I appalled? Yes. Was I disappointed? Extremely so. In my mind, a layman's mind, all I saw was a threat against my life and a threat against people who were working for me. They felt, however, in their professional opinion, that the evidence wasn't there. So, you know, we had to follow whatever their advice was at that point. Could we have done more? Perhaps, you know, we could have taken out a restraining order, but we felt, again, that that would only antagonize things and make it worse. Quite frankly, and looking back at it now, I think had we taken that course and become more aggressive, I think it would just provoke him to take an action earlier than what he did.
Yeah, it's pretty shocking.
The point to...
Yeah, go ahead.
It is. And, Wolf, the point here, I think, is that, you know, once we sensed something was amiss here, we took the precautionary role of making sure that the staff was aware of what was happening. It was a common discussion in the newsroom. We gave them a photo of Mr. Ramos in case he would enter the newsroom. And again, this is in a different building, so it's not the same building. And also, we had given a photo to the front desk with my personal instruction that if anybody that resembled him would come through the door, that they were to call 911 and our own security. So from the standpoint of realizing a threat, I think we assessed it appropriately, and unfortunately, it was an accurate perception.
Yeah, and I think newsrooms all over the country right now are taking a closer look at security and learning some lessons from what occurred in Annapolis, and I'm sure they're going to be consulting with you down the road as well. What are the lessons that all of us should learn from this horrible situation? While I still have you, and we don't have a lot of time, but I know you were close with four of the five victims, and give me a thought about each. Let's start with Bob Hyacin.
Bob Hyacin, who I didn't work with for a long time, he had just come recently, just before I retired. But Bob was an incredible mentor to people in the newsroom, young reporters, young editors. I mean, he was a calming voice in that newsroom, also an inspiring voice, and an incredibly gifted writer with a sense of humor. And it's difficult to write humor, good humor, but through his column, he definitely did that. But he was just a joy to be around.
What about Wendy Winters?
Wendy Winters, an incredible person who I had hired just to do your typical community news stories. There were freelance stories involving everything from the soapbox derby to a local cooking contest. You know, stories that were inconsequential, but were well read because we're a local newspaper. She wrote so much that she became the most prolific writer in the newsroom, and we hired her on as a reporter. But very charming person who would bring me and others in the newsroom a cake every Christmas time. So very friendly to the staff, really wanted to immerse herself in news journalism. Certainly was not ready to retire.
John McNamara?
John McNamara was a diehard Terps fan, loved covering Terps sports, liked covering the Capital hockey team. Actually left the newspaper for a couple years, missed it, came back. And persevered, all sorts of layoffs, ownership changes, and declining readership, and took on extra responsibilities just to keep his job there.
And Gerald Fishman.
Gerald Fishman was a character. Everything that you've heard about him was right on the button. I mean, he's a guy who wore a cardigan sweater and a tie to work every day. Very proud of what he did, unassuming, shy, introverted, tried to get on Jeopardy twice and failed. A guy who could turn prose like anybody I've ever seen, was certainly capable of writing great editorials for major metropolitan newspapers, but loved his position at the Capitol.
And I know you didn't know Rebecca Smith, the 34-year-old sales assistant, but no. Our deepest, deepest condolences to her family, to her friends, to all of the family and friends of these victims. They certainly did not deserve what happened yesterday. Tom, thanks so much for joining us, and we appreciate your thoughts.
Thank you, Wolf.